Let us begin. It's a real pleasure to welcome Patrick Schumacher, who is partner and the senior designer at Zaha Hadid Architects, which he joined in 1988, and whose most recently completed buildings, the Maxi Center of Contemporary Art and Architecture in Rome and the Guangzhou Opera House, just to name two, have opened to international acclaim. The awards which he shares credit for at Zaha Hadid Architects are too numerous to list, but certainly the Sterling Prize deserves mention. Schumacher is the founding director of the Design Research Lab at the AA and is a tenured professor at Innsbruck University. Among his solo projects, the monumental two volumes of the Autopoiesis of Architecture clearly stand out, creating a significant contribution to contemporary discourse in architecture. Schumacher's multifaceted synthetic argument presents architecture as a coherent discipline, no small feat if you think of the apparent variety of contemporary architectural production. Rather than address his super theory frontally, which surely would take too long, if I even was up for the task, I'd like to make an observation about a similar, though much more limited, argument made by Philip Johnson and Henry Russell Hitchcock in 1932. I'm talking, of course, about the International Style Exhibition at the MoMA, which presented the modernist avant-garde of the time as a unified front, despite the many apparent differences between individual practitioners. Johnson enumerated the characteristics of international styles first and foremost, he said, involving the structural necessity and functional requirements. And he goes on to describe very specifically certain characteristics. First, that architecture would be volume, not mass. Second, its order would be derived from regularity rather than certain kinds of axial symmetry. It would not ever allow for arbitrary decoration or ornamentation. And there would be other things, white walls, flat roofs. And with this exhibition, really what we saw was that modern architecture became a style rather than the political movement that it had been for many of its authors and promoters in Europe. In this way, the exhibition paved the way for a reconciled relationship between the progressive architectural forms and capitalism and its aspirations toward internationalism. Similarly, Schumacher has proposed to unify architecture, this time with parametricism. Structure and function are substituted with types of formal malleability driven by the many variables informing a building today, variables that certainly were not present 100 years ago. And as a result, we have curves. Curves become ubiquitous and the straight lines subside. You see here that he's doing something quite different. And in fact, he has said, and this is a quote, "Students today would rather have their hands fall off than draw a straight line." And this may be true. And so we see that curves are the first principle of parametricism for him. The second is that order is achieved through similarity rather than repetition. We've all witnessed the proliferation of gradients, of differences within families of forms that have replaced modularity of the old variety. And finally, the third, if I were to break him down into three as I did the international style, it would be a return to decoration and ornament, but this time functionalized, or even at the urban scale rather than the scale of the facade. Architecture is free again to express accretion rather than reduction. In sum, Schumacher dares to claim that there is indeed, again, a pervasive style despite all of postmodernism's claims to pluralism. And like Johnson before, he has staked out a collective project. This is very important, very radical, and I look forward to hearing more about it from Patrick himself. Thank you so much for coming tonight.
Thanks a lot, Scott, for the insightful introduction. And welcome, everybody. Good evening. It's my pleasure to be here after 18 years, literally. And looking back, I think that already 18 years ago, what we were trying to do here at the school and a year earlier at Columbia University was already part of a project which, in retrospect, now deserves a kind of name to move forward. And if you look at, and the comparison with international style is quite pertinent. The exhibition was launched about also a bit over a decade after modernism has fomented and started to experiment and develop a style which then was ready from the 30s onwards to change the physiognomy of this planet in terms of the built environment and the totality of the world of artifacts. If you look back at the Bauhaus and what was researched and discussed and set into principles in the early 20s, then took on for 50 years and changed the physiognomy of the 20th century, urbanism, architecture, interior, and product design. This lecture will be primarily elaboration, some aspects of my theoretical treatise. I will also, but I am primarily an architect, the designing architect, so as a reminder of that, I will just click through some of the recent works, and I will come again back to some of that without discussing it in detail, though. I will not talk so much in detail about the projects, but I think it's important to see that the reflections, the theoretical reflections are an attempt on my part to make sense of my career, my intuitions, and my investments in the work, but also I think it's expanding to try to understand the investments which are collective investments which are taking place over a decade and really a global convergence I see of many, many young architects globally buying into certain sets of repertoires, principles, and ways of working. And this phrase, complex variegated order, is perhaps what describes what you've just seen. And I think that architecture's task now is to organize and articulate the societal complexity of post-Fordist network society. And the motivation for a new epochal style must be a kind of shift in the way the society operates and works. And that was also the motivation of modernism, the beginning of the 20th century, with the advent of a new industrial mass society. And now we're talking about a new kind of post-industrial, perhaps post-Fordist network society as a motivation to and raison d'etre for a new kind of set of principles for architecture. So to be clear about where architecture should go, one should develop a very principled understanding of architecture's societal function. And as far as I'm concerned, its function is the innovative ordering and framing of communicative interaction. And this kind of framing and ordering of all societal processes is what it's all about. It's not about the triviality of putting a roof over our head and protecting us from the environment and the beasts, as it were. That is, these aspects, technical aspects of enveloping and is left to the engineering disciplines. What architecture is all about is ordering social processes. And to imagine that, to understand that dependency on all social processes of being ordered in space, we should just imagine a city like Boston with several million people just being exposed to a undifferentiated tarmac surface, and imagine how social processes could operate. They would obviously, all social order and distinctions would collapse. This notion of architectural order has for me two aspects which are to be distinguished. The one is organization, which has to do with physical distancing and separation. And second very important aspect is the aspect of articulation, which is further distinguished into the aspect of phenomenological articulation, which reflects on that the order needs to be a perceptually palpable, conspicuous order, which can be perceived and comprehended by sentient beings, whereas organization is just about the physical ordering of bodies in space. But also further, there's the aspect of semiological articulation, which has to do with the fact that the built environment also is the domain which in which society recognizes itself through and via socialized learning actors who are operating in an environment under which is in effect a system of signification. And that becomes now, for me, a specific agenda for architecture to work on. So in terms of the design project, in terms of the three key notions which I'm developing in particular in the beginning of volume two of my treatise, is parametric organization, parametric phenomenology, and parametric semiology as three dimensions and aspects which I think deserve to be pushed and are the dimensions along which the discipline should upgrade its capacity to order social processes. So architecture's task and core competency has three dimensions: organization, articulation, and signification. Organization recognizes that social communication depends on the physical arrangement, gathering, and separating of physical bodies in space. Articulation recognizes that cognitive sentient bodies navigate space via perception. And signification recognizes that these sentient socialized learning bodies navigate and act on the basis of signs. And the more society progresses, the less and the more social complexity increases, becomes more nuanced, and communication processes become more simultaneous and diversified, the more the built environment can no longer operate through physical processes of distancing and separation by physical walls, as if you could do with cattle, channeling them through stables. But the more you have to kind of rely on the active navigation of space along nuanced signs of systems of signification. So the design project, in fact, has three dimensions: the organizational project, the phenomenological project, and the semiological project. And I think that every designer, in fact, intuitively operates along these dimensions, but it's not usually explicitly reflected. But a talented designer is always already operating. He's always already testing the appearance, the legibility of his or her compositions, and is worrying about their particular meaning dimension, their semantic connotations, and expressive qualities and atmospheres. Again, here, the way I see this, the framing project, the kind of ordering that in urban space implies that, first of all, the participants of communication find each other in an urban environment, are gathered and brought into a meaningful constellation, which is done through the kind of architectural settings which define particular communicative situations. This is the societal function of architecture. It has these aspects. First of all, there is a physical frame to structure physical bodies, soliciting passive movement. There is a phenomenological project, constructing perceptual frames for sentient beings and soliciting active behavior. But finally, the semiological project is in fact operating a communicative frame, and is itself, the environment becomes a communication, announcing and inviting participants to join scenarios and settings and situations which are expressed and offered through the architecture, and therefore soliciting communicative action. But the space itself is already a communicative action of the host institution, like the space is a communication of the GSD for us to be brought together in particular constellation called a lecture. So there are three functions of architectural systems of signification. That is navigation, or just to find the relevant participants. There's orientation, to bring them in particular constellations, and there's immersion, which means you have to be brought into a particular mood and mode and frame of mind. You need to be primed for particular communicative situations. And all this, these aspects and nuances are embedded in information-rich environments which we navigate, orient, and immerse within. So the meaning of architectural science, or the meaning of, I quote Wittgenstein, the meaning of a word, and in fact any sign is its use, and the same is the meaning of a space or territory is its use. And the kind of territory is in fact the minimal unit of architectural signification. It's like the sentence in the spoken language is a unit. Individual word means nothing. I can just say dog and nobody, I'm not communicating, but I need to create a full sentence, and equivalent in terms of architectural language is I need to constitute a territory which I step into, and that makes a difference with respect to where I am and what to expect and which communicative situation I am participating in. So a territory is something where something can take place, an activity, an event, a particular social interaction. And so only a territory is a full communication. That means something that calls for being either accepted or rejected, like any communication. I accept the communication when I enter the territory and participate in the respective interaction scenario, and I kind of therefore subject myself to the particular institutional rules that are embedded in this space, in the territory, or I reject the communication when I don't enter or exit the territory. So the architectural sign is the territory, and all the other aspects, like perhaps floors, columns, furniture, elements, all the elements and aspects through which we compose territories are only sign radicals. They don't make full communications, but they are built up through kind of grammar ways of constructing meaningful communicative territories. I will only leave it at this point with these few hints of aspects of volume 2, where I'm trying a kind of refoundation of architectural semiology on the basis as an of the general framework of the parametric paradigm. And I've started to work with students at Innsbruck, Vienna, and at the AA with this concept of developing an architecture as a coherent system of signification in abstraction and radical isolation from the kind of spontaneous semiosis and familiar science systems of the built environment, which I believe are too fragmented and lacking informational density. So we're stepping out and developing a project from the bottom up. And I will not explain this, because this is perhaps another lecture where I need to come back and elaborate this. I just give you a quick glimpse of what this kind of work looks like. It's building up systems of distinction in the formal domain and correlating it with system of distinctions in the interaction domain or social domain. And I just click through that. It's the attempt to build up a kind of repertoire of spatial organization and networks of similitude and difference, differences that make a difference with respect to interaction events, and trying to build up an information-rich environment in this fashion. This is just a glimpse I wanted to give you. And another hint, the way we're now trying to incorporate the meaning dimension, which is actually the activity aspects, the interaction scenarios which are correlated and connected and associated with a particular aspects and features of the built environment, they can be now incorporated into the model by means of crowd simulation. But these are not kind of engineering crowds which have to do with evacuation and escape and circulation only, but they are functional crowds which we're now trying to model all aspects of and patterns of social occupation and patterns and institutions of communicative interaction in space and call it and script it and associate it to various features, which in the through this correlation becomes the signifiers of these behaviors and actions. So this is just a glimpse at the semiological projects, which I'm just starting to work on, but in terms of theoretical premises I've developed in volume 2 as a kind of axiomatic for the semiological project in architecture. Okay, but in terms of the lecture here, I'm going a bit back to the theses of some of the theses of volume 1, and just note here that the two phrases I'm kind of known for recently is on the one hand parametricism as a new epochal style for architecture and urbanism, and on the other hand the outer purposes of architecture, the title of my theoretical edifice. And what we're having with these two phrases is on the one hand a unified hegemonic style. I think the style is still an avant-garde style and has kind of cleared the market nearly in terms of the avant-garde segment of architecture. I think this is the only game in town here, but it hasn't reached out into the mainstream, and it's pushing into the mainstream, and I think it's ready. It's built up for over a decade, a repertoire and intelligence, and it needs to further upgrade and needs to be argued for by what I think is a unified theory of architecture, which starts with understanding the societal function of architecture. So that's the project ultimately for me as a practicing architect, is to push this kind of work into the mainstream. I mean, we are starting with Zahedid Architects, growing from 4 to 400 with projects all over the world, but it's still a drop in the ocean, and I invite everybody to participate. And I want to push this concept of parametricism also out into the general public and make it happen. What modernism did for the 21st century, parametricism should be doing for the 21st century, because one thing is clear, since the crisis of modernism, there have been kind of 30 years of experimentation and confusion and stops and starts and no real impact back into the built environment. And it's about time. So the book is an unusual piece of work. The two volumes run into over 1,000 pages, 1,200 pages. It's not something I set out to do like this initially, but I've been reflecting about my work and developed my work and observed other people's work and trying to make sense of it over the years. And the attempt here is to create a comprehensive and coherent theoretical edifice. The theory is architecture within the framework of communication theory. Now, whether it is comprehensive and coherent, you should test yourself. That's something you could, if you go through the book, you tell me if there's questions left open and unanswered, and whether there are still kind of unresolved contradictions within the positions I'm taking. It is initially developed, in fact, as a discourse analysis of architecture as global self-determined system of communication. So it's descriptive, it's trying to reflect on how we today discuss architecture, which categories we are employing, which methods we're using, which kind of arguments we consider valid, and which values we're pushing. So it's just describing that, and also trying to understand how this discourse we are now inhabiting has evolved over the years and decades and centuries. But then in the next step is trying to kind of select and explain and rationalize our ways of thinking and the categories and the discourse we're inhabiting. And out of that rationalization, first of all, I realized I have a lot of respect for the accumulated wisdom of a discipline and expert discourse which have been growing over decades and centuries. And this evolution means something. We need to understand its pertinence, but also then to select and turn normative out of the descriptive and select those aspects which we need to maintain and work on, and those also making proposals about how the discourse might be upgraded further. So it is a unified theory. I mean, usually different authors pick on different topics, different questions are raised and discussed in the various articles. I mean, I've published about 70, 80 articles over the last 15 years, and I've been always watching out and seeing if this kind of adds up to something, if there are underlying principles and a coherency in approach so that we don't reject and dispute in one article issues and aspects we've argued in another article, that if we're going into crits and arguing for certain and demand, making certain demands on architecture in one scenario and one day, that we're not standing in the way and rejecting that another day, it demands a kind of specific effort. It's not automatic that all the different utterances and ideas which come to mind in different questions and aspects fall into a coherent system. So that's an elaborate work which I've been trying to do, and it takes much longer to get to a point and build up a kind of theory than a kind of article length position. And these are the different aspects which I'm trying to cover. So it starts with the understanding of, most importantly, of architecture's societal function. Then it's a question of demarcating architecture, distinguishing from neighboring disciplines and professions like the art system on the one hand and engineering sciences on the other hand. And I'm very clear that there is a radical distinction here and that there's a core competency which cannot be, should not be mixed up with these other domains. That there is something like the avant-garde, which has stabilized since the mid-20th century, and as a structure, this distinction of avant-garde and mainstream is a structure which I believe is here to stay. And we are working within the avant-garde in schools like this and in younger and smaller experimental design practices, but we also need to move our work into the mainstream. That must be the task without rearguard nor avant-garde. Of course, there's a theory of the design medium, which is extremely important, as we all know. And I will not talk about it too much here, the whole transformation of the discipline, our methods and ways of working and capacities and repertoires based on the new computational design processes. But I will discuss that on Saturday. There's a conference in Yale on the drawing and on the so-called death of the drawing. ? And I invite anybody who's interested to hear about that to come to Yale. That is my contribution will be Saturday morning. And then aesthetic theory, the question of what is the significance of aesthetic values. I mean, our investment in aesthetic values is enormous. And when we at Zadid Architects work, most of our passion and energy, and a lot of our passion and energy, goes into satisfying sophisticated aesthetic ambitions. So the question is that meaningful? What does it mean? Why should it be defended? And what is important about it? These kind of questions are answered. And also there's a theory of style within the mix. And of course this concept has been kind of battered and rejected, but I think it would just impoverish our discourse if we would let it go, and there's a clear role for it, and also not only within the discipline and discourse, but also within larger societal audiences. This is the key category which through which we need to think architecture. So all of these aspects fit together. I can't explore that here, but all of these aspects answered and coherently brought together lead me to taking a confident position with respect to contemporary architecture and its future. Now, what this implies is, in a sense, that architectural theory must be embedded within an updated theory of society. And that's a task of architectural theorists, if you like. Can't expect from every architect to dwell and delve into sociology, philosophy, and the theory of society. But I think from architectural theorists, we must demand so. And we can, as architectural theorists, of course, not develop our own account and theory of society, but we need to be able to scan the field and trying to grasp where the most sophisticated, elaborate, and state-of-the-art societal theory is at the moment, and trying to tie up to that. And I've always been trying to think what I'm doing in terms of architecture in larger terms. And for over a decade, from the early 80s to the mid 90s, I've been trying to think the role of architecture and urbanism in terms of Marxian theory of society. And I have since the mid 90s discovered that there is, first of all, of course, Marxism suffered some blows with the disintegration of communism, and in the mid-90s, early 90s, we had also the post-Marxist theories of post-structuralism, etc., and which are primarily critical negative in import and don't deliver a social theory. And I've discovered in the mid-90s the emergence of a very powerful new social theory out of systems theory and complexity theory. These insights have been flowing into a very sophisticated, comprehensive theoretical edifice. The author is Niklas Luhmann, and has generated a large following ship, first of all in Germany, but more and more, also, I think, globally. And I've been tying my work to Luhmann's social system theory and theory of modern society as functionally differentiated society. I can't go too much into it, but in volume one, there's a lot of discussion and explanation and summary of his work and how architecture is tied into it. Basically, the main idea is that in terms of general periodization, Luhmann is not only looking at the economy like Marx in terms of different socioeconomic eras, but he's looking at modes of societal differentiation. As society, tribal societies are just simply segmented into parallel little tribes, and then you have a kind of structure center periphery, moving on to kind of highly stratified societal models in the feudal area. And basically what for Marx was the shift from feudalism to capitalism, in Luhmann's terms, is a shift from stratified society, from stratification to functional differentiation as a primary mode of differentiation. And it is no longer assuming, like Marx, that the economy is a kind of basic driver and structure, but that all aspects of societal buildup of complexity are equally relevant. And we have, in fact, a co-evolution of so-called function systems. So there's a political system, a legal system, an economy, the science, the system of the sciences, education system, etc., the mass media system, the art system. These are the major autonomous now discourses which have separated out, set themselves autonomous, developed discourses and also textual reflections, and they are controlling and leading the different aspects which need to be covered in every society. Every society needs a form of government, and every society needs a form of law, needs to find a kind of way of distributing and organizing production. It needs some way of kind of maintaining and elaborating knowledge, etc., etc. So these are universal exigencies of every society, but in modern, functionally differentiated society, they have been separated out into autonomous, self-governing discourses, whereas in feudalism, for instance, the political power, the economic power, the power over knowledge was all kind of integrated into one single hierarchy, where the top of the hierarchy, the aristocracy and king would kind of unify all these aspects into a kind of stratified order. And that has kind of totally been broken, and we're now having a kind of co-evolution of autonomous subsystems. And I am just reading through all these treatises and explanations of these function systems and realize that architecture and design must be theorized and can be theorized as one of those function systems. Well, Luhmann has integrated into the art system, I think, which is an anachronism. Architecture and design is precisely such a co-evolving autonomous function system. And I was very happy here, I'm in color and smiling. So architecture, together with the other design disciplines, constitutes one of the great autopoietic function systems of modern functionally differentiated society. So the discourse of architecture and design claims exclusive universal competency concerning the built environment and the world of all artifacts, understood as frames and interfaces of communicative interaction. So I'm also saying that all products, interiors, also the fashion system is all part of this framing of communicative interaction. But we also realize that in today's world, nothing gets built or produced which isn't influenced by the discourse which we are constructing the next stage of, like in the 20th century, basically nothing which was produced or built remained untouched by the advances and thinking and leadership of the Bauhaus. So anything which happens anywhere in the world, first of all, a connected global discourse is immediately recognized and published and circulating on the web, so everybody communicates in a global communication process, and this discourse is filtering out and influencing back, so nothing gets produced which isn't gone through and validated through that needle's eye of that discourse, which we as here are one of its primary hubs. So our influence and responsibility is rather momentous. So here's just a kind of picture the way architecture is slotted into a kind of global picture of society, which I constructed on the basis of Luhmann's writing. He never created such a matrix, so I'm just going to systematize this, that architecture is analyzed in parallel to the other subsystems of society. And there's a series of key categories by which all of these can be compared and analyzed. So each of these function systems has a particular lead distinctions, a key distinction which structures the totality of the discourse. In architecture, it's form versus function. Everything revolves around form and function, and you can nearly define the task of architecture to give form to function, and that is directly in parallel to, for instance, in the sciences, everything is about theory versus evidence. The essential task of science is to give evidence to theories or theorize empirical evidence. Another one in the legal system is all about norms versus facts. It's about the norming of facts and the question whether particular facts or acts are operating within the norm, etc. So you have these lead distinctions. These spurn binary codes, and binary codes are questions and evaluative knife edges, if you like, which structure the discourse. If you want to be a scientist and participate in science, you have to subject yourself to the question true versus false, or probable versus improbable, and that's the only aspect you have to worry about. You don't have to worry about the justice of what you're talking about. You don't have to worry about the beauty of what you're talking about, the legality, or the kind of progressive versus politically regressive aspects. You're only interested and concerned about truth versus false. And so each of them, and then in the legal system, it only is about legal, illegal. It has nothing to do with politics. Economics shouldn't interfere. Science doesn't come into it. These are fully autonomous discourses. And the same goes with architecture, where everything revolves about form and functions, about the beautiful versus the ugly, as well as the useful versus the useless, what I call the double code of utility and beauty. And so each of these function systems has this kind of binary code, which is very abstract and the same throughout centuries. The double code of utility and beauty is 500 years old in architecture. Science has always been about truth versus false, etc. And these are very abstract, very general. They're so-called, what I call, permanent communication structures of the function system. And therefore, they need to be reinterpreted and programmed. There need to be particular concrete criteria in each historical era. What is the beautiful? What is the useful? Or how to identify the true versus the false in each era. So we need to program, there's the kind of the flexible or historically variable communication structure is interpreting these codes in each era anew, and the styles of architecture are interpreting in each era how to identify the formally resolved and the functional. And the same in the like paradigms in the sciences, ideologies in politics, constitution and statutes in the legal system, etc. So just some indications here how this matrix of terms is able to draw out parallels and see how these different systems which co-evolve have a kind of underlying similitude of conceptual structure. So again, the societal function of architecture is the innovative ordering and framing of communicative interaction. What is important here, that the architectural frames, the design settings and spaces are themselves communications. They are communications that define, premise and prime the communicative interactions that are expected to take place in the respectively framed territory. And I will now go back into the deeper history and prehistory of architecture and the built environment to indicate that what is here is becoming a kind of conscious theory-led effort of design, the designing as built environments, as communications and systems of signification, has always already been unconsciously happening and operating. So I think what is very important, that this kind of societal function of architecture is rooted in a deeper societal function of the built environment, which we as architectural discourse are kind of now in charge of. And this built environment has a very, very important role in cultural evolution. So my argument is that the becoming man out of the animal kingdom, also the establishment of society, relies on the built environment as a kind of long-term social memory and necessary material substrate of the evolution. So I'm saying that biological evolution has as a material substrate on which mutation, selection, reproduction operates cross-generationally is the DNA. And in terms of the cultural revolution, that material substrate is in fact the kind of built environment which is gradually, unconsciously, through mutation, selection, reproduction, building up societal complexity, building up a social order. And it's a course generationally stable and a kind of evolving society can kind of build and rebuild and work up its own complexity tied and hooked up with this kind of new level of this new evolutionary substrate. So instead of a small flock of apes, which are relatively undifferentiated, and with each generation have to kind of relearn and restructure it's anew, only based on instinct. We have here the chance to build up in history a more complex, a more differentiated social cooperative organism on the basis of plotting out distinctions through these settlement structures. And I think at the same time as we're using these kind of spatial differentiations, they are not only organized spatially, separating out and locating out, they're also morphologically differentiated, so they become also a kind of system of signification at that point. And you can see the way a social organism is structured through different positions, different types of participants, the young versus the old, male, female, tribe A versus tribe B, and the way the different activities are plotted out and set out and structure and allow the buildup of social complexity. And this also includes, which we find also absolutely ubiquitous in all societies, the kind of emphasis on overcoming the lack of structure in the kind of flock of apes, if you like, and building up structure and identifiable character mass and social identities through self-ornamentation, through, of course, tools and instruments. And this is still happening today in terms of the fashion system, that we are not only relying on various particularly designed and articulated settings to communicate, but we also dress up for particular occasions and engage in particular human interactions And we can also navigate a field of social actors by intuitively and quickly reacting to these visual clues. So the visual language of the design disciplines together with architecture create this kind of system of signification. And the same aspect not only of spatial order but of orders of similitude and morphologies and signification systems are also operating in the through aspects of ornamentation in the built environment as well. So, and these kind of build-up of a social organism throughout the centuries follows initially is nearly like a kind of material process where the walls are circular because that's the most efficient. It's like a kind of bacteria colony or cell structure. It is. It has a kind of nearly material base of using these kind of circles and circles within circles and divisions. And then there's a kind of accretion of complexity with building ring upon ring and articulating certain organs within that, like the guild hall and the church and the marketplace. And you have this kind of accretion of an organism at a particular stage of history and building up a social complexity. And then this is kind of a particular stage of history can only go so far and is then repeated across the landscape. They all look a little bit different, but they all follow the same genotype and never increased across beyond a certain stage. It's kind of feudal landscape, agricultural landscape, which crystallizes these trading and handicraft centers. And all of this is like a quasi-material process. There's no planning, there's no consciousness, no reflection, no polemics, no discourse. It's just a kind of trial and error, mutation, selection, reproduction, unconscious evolution. So it's an evolutionary process based on the built environment as the kind of DNA of cultural evolution. And then we have this, what I call the Big Bang of architecture, the emergence of architecture for the first time, turning this unconscious, tradition-bound building, where it's always about the repetition and stabilization and maintenance of the same with very, very small incremental improvements, perhaps. Suddenly there's this kind of plane of invention. There's a kind of radical positioning and self-consciousness of innovation. It is also moving, it's for the first time creating architects, separating out of this kind of self-built process of the vernacular or of the kind of construction colonies and master builders with roaming the land. And you have the architect pulling away, separating out and designing in advance of construction and moving the process from direct engagement with the physical world onto paper. So at that point, you have also the drawing as a new medium of design separating out. Of course, when they first start, they're just drawing what has evolved up to that point. They're just drawing and rationalizing the kind of evolved medieval city. But as a first step, but then they're already rationalizing it and very, very quickly build up, gain control, and there's innovation. And there is immediately theoretical discourse and texts and authors. All these aspects didn't exist before. So we have to pull the architect out, go into the drawing, innovate, and that requires argument, because if you just keep repeating what has always been done, no argument is required. But if you change and innovate, you need to argument, you need to write. And these kind of drawings were then published and disseminated and a kind of projected back into the landscape. And you have the first kind of ideal cities, the first planned and built cities. And also in terms of architectural buildings, for the first time you have fully designed buildings, fully designed and detailed before construction, visualized with perspectives, which was never happened before. That's why in my theory of architecture as I understand it starts with the Renaissance and all prior aspects I call tradition-bound building. And the Gothic is perhaps a transitional phase, but in the Gothic you still don't have author architects, you don't have theory, discourse, writings, and no Gothic structure has been fully designed before construction. So, but the move, the expansion from then on with that big bang of architecture, the history accelerates rapidly. It's actually in parallel with other aspects, like the, for the first time, the sciences emancipate, go into innovation, into writing, into critique, into publishing. The political system suddenly is critiqued through people like Hobbes, Montesquieu, etc. And you have parallel discourses suddenly taking on all these aspects of society. And you have a kind of rapid acceleration of European society. And you're moving from the order of the mercantile city-states of Florence and Venice to the national economy, where the order of the architecture projects out to the horizon and cuts through the landscape. It's not longer like here, floating in a kind of amorphous, unstructured territory, but there's a total claim of structuring a national territory through cutting canals, streets, and these kind of projects, and society organized on a much grander scale. And therefore, we're moving from, and these kind of visions are elaborated, and I'm trying to tie this in with the shift from the Renaissance style to the Baroque style. So the great advantage of the Baroque style is that, in fact, it can constitute these much larger, unified, integral organizations on a much larger scale. And it does so by particular means which are integrative, using convex and concave curvature, using asymmetry in its parts to mirror out into a more stronger global impacting symmetry. So you can have these kind of capacity. The new capacity of the Baroque style is this kind of plasticity and deep relief also help for long distance viewing. So I'm trying to understand what is the advantages, what is the superiority and capacity of the Baroque over the Renaissance. Why is the development of the style from the Renaissance to the Baroque an advance, a progressive advance, and tied in with new demands made on architecture? So that the series of sequence of style is not just the kind of fashion or an aspect of willful change, but there is a kind of, there's a progress which needs to be explicated. So here again you have these aspects where you have a much more unifying, integral composition which can tie in and hold tension between many more parts, which would fall apart in the Renaissance, which is ultimately an additive process where each unit is in itself symmetrically constituted and larger compositions are just additive of autonomous, self-focused units, and you cannot build up larger complexes legibly and perceptually palpable. So here again, the kind of Baroque operates with curvature, so the continuity of curvature ties in together, and also the local asymmetry is kind of very powerful. When it's mirrored over, then you really get the impression of a very, very strong unity, because the probability of this being mirrored means it must have a kind of strong organization. It cannot be accidental. So the more we perceive a kind of asymmetry flipped into a symmetry, the more powerful and unifying is the image. And that, I think, was discovered in the Baroque, and we also try to learn from this. And once you work like this, you can actually then afford even local asymmetries and still tie in powerful figures. There is a lot of asymmetry in this, but the kind of amorphousness, asymmetry, even imperfectly mirrored, creates a very, very strong unity in the building. So this is, I dwelt on this for a bit, because this is the kind of analysis we should conduct when we look at great epochal styles, which not only, we not shouldn't be worried about the influences and what led to it, that's incidental, but what makes such a style successful, pervasive, clearing the market and taking over a whole epoch. It must mean something, it must have striking and powerful advantages. Now, the next style I want to talk about, which is so congenial to a totally new societal era, is modernism. But in between the Baroque and this kind of modernism, we have actually a style of the picturesque. And Tafuri explains to us that the picturesque is, in fact, an aesthetic adaptation to the era of early laissez-faire capitalism, where you have you're moving from a kind of Mertekalentist, absolute, planned nation-state, like France of Louis XIV and the city, you know, planned cities, the Baroque cities, to a kind of free-for-all, free-market, early capitalist agglomeration, which cannot be so ordered, and which needs to be kind of accumulate kind of nearly randomly, and that generates a kind of sense and the vitality of these kind of new centers demand an aesthetic revolution, the revolution of the picturesque. And then when capitalism becomes again more organized, you have the kind of concentration of capital in huge agglomerations and cartels, and you have a new level of industrialization and mechanical reproduction. Then you have this aesthetic, this capacity, the endless repetition and serialization of structures and spaces. So proportion and symmetry gets out of the window. You also have concrete and steel making that possible. And you have this kind of order. You have the separation of functions and their specialization, and then the kind of reconstitution in incomplete agglomerative compositions. So we always have in modernism the principle of separation, specialization. Each part could be radically different. It's not unified and stuffed into the kind of symmetrical, well-proportioned Baroque palace. Connections are minimized to keep independence, and then internally there is repetition. These principles are the principle of modernism, and they go through from the 1920s all the way to the high tech of the 1970s. So again, the principles are at the advantage, instead of stuffing everything into one preconceived envelope, you have now a proliferation of different functions, different life processes. The society becomes more manifold and more differentiated, more complex. So you pull apart the functions, so each component has the advantage of being optimized in separation, so it is own, each volume has its own height, its own depth, its own floor to floor, its own facade. So there's a kind of apartment building in the Bauhaus, the administration building, the workshop building, so you have the chance to specialize, separate out, and optimize. And this is exactly how you would stitch together a machine. And again, the principles are radically different parts, pulled apart, minimizing connection, internal repetition. And the same principles go to the industrial city. Le Corbusier is separating out the business district from the residential district, from the logistics and production district. He's even having a gap between those to that there is no interference. They could be radically different from each other, but internally repetitive. And it's always the same, and all the way to through all the subsidiary styles of modernism, whether you look at the white modernism, you look at brutalism, you look at metabolism, you look at high-tech, it's always the same. And these are the principles also of industrial design, of machine engineering, of the modernist organization. It's a kind of bureaucratic corporation where all the different parts are separated out, specialized out, keep separate, and then they're beavering away in isolation along the optimized stretch path. And this is a congenial architecture, congenial to the principles of what I call Fordist mass reproduction society, where you have a handful of functionally differentiated aspects of life, and they're repeated forever, producing a kind of universal consumption standard, a new level of material plenty, unprecedented with respect to world history. So in the 1960s in Germany, every one of 660 million people has a standard of living on these principles, which is much higher than Louis XIV, the Sun King, where everybody has their industrially constructed house, a car in front, flowing water, a washing machine, a TV with two channels, industrial food on the table, everything the same, everything super productive, super convenient, the same healthcare, etc., etc. So this order of repetition of the universal consumption standard is kind of breaking apart in the 70s, going through a crisis, that we have the chance to, on that basis of this material plenty, these kind of, the next stage of civilization is no longer possible on these principles. And you have a kind of dystopian critique of these kind of models. You have a rehabilitation of the historic centers, the kind of need to bring productive units together again instead of settling out and separating out everything onto the green field where you can beaver away for 10, 20 years in an optimized kind of location and environment. We're now talking about a diversification of tastes, of individuality, the idea of faster cycles of innovation, the more sophisticated production technology is allowed to kind of mass customize, and this kind of world and order of production and society is no longer feasible. And we have this kind of expression of the crisis of modernism in postmodernism or in drawings like this, the kind of sense that these environments are too repetitive, too monotonous, no longer complex enough. We need to have a more intense communication, we need to gather more, we need to, architecture needs to speak again. I think postmodernism looked at contradiction and complexity in architecture, looked at the kind of richness of the historical environment and tried to draw out new principles. I think these were taken up by deconstructivism. So whatever postmodernism discovered in terms of richness of an architectural repertoire, in terms of the, let's say, complexity and collaging of spaces and features, were drawn out and kind of freed of the irrelevant, let's say, historical source material and abstracted into deconstructivism. And we have suddenly developing a repertoire which tries to bring things together, which tries to interpenetrate and rather than separate out and in a variation instead of repetition, interpenetration instead of isolation, etc. And even harking back to earlier artistic models, because these, although these were created in the modern era, they couldn't be congenial to the mass forest society. But at a later stage, these models could come to fruition in the work of Zaha Hadid, Liebeskind, Tschumi, the kind of, instead of separating out the layers, like Corbusier, the different layers in their radical difference are superimposed, so you have simultaneous competing reference system describing the same space. And we in Columbia University in 93, we took up this idea of kind of layering, and instead of collaging these layers in kind of indifference to each other, we tried to see if whether these layers could kind of correlate and react and reflect each other and build up a texture which has maybe more order and coherence than the simple radical superimposition of Tschumi. These are the first glimpses of the kind of paradigm of parametric urbanism we're now talking about, although at that time still very, very chaotic and undigested. So some of these developments and refinements and the attempt to create rich, diversified urban textures with the higher sense of integration and order. The same would we tried with the work environments. It was important for us that these new repertoires are not just used in an artistic sense for museums and special art spaces, but they are relevant in terms of the organization, articulation of high-performance productive spaces. So we looked at bureau landschafts and the contemporary business organizations, the way they are no longer following the model of these kind of neatly separated bureaucratic departments and sub-departments which are separated from each other and homogeneous within, but you have a kind of system of overlap and interpenetration, multiple overlapping domains of competency, continuous reconfiguration and self-organization of team structures, etc., in these kind of porous structures where everything ultimately needs to communicate with everything else. And we also won a competition where we could show, instead of the modernist way of separating out an administration building next to a factory, to put it right in the center and have engineering management, auditing, and social communication spaces integrated into the flow of production. And we are creating a kind of environment which is this kind of porous space of simultaneity where everything communicates with everything else, because in today's post-photos network society, what we're arguing is that we cannot afford to be kind of given a task and go down a kind of corridor and isolate ourselves and beaver away in a kind of isolated cell. We need to continuously network and update our what we're doing, what everybody else is doing. We need to continuously worry about the relevancy of what we are working and how it ties and coordinates with what everybody else is doing, not only within the firm but beyond the firm. And the firms are kind of networking and clustering and assembling, and you have a kind of total intensification of communication on many levels, electronically as well as spatially. So, and these are the spaces, I think, which symbolize that and activate this, that when you're in such a space, you can see the rich kind of offerings and potential scenarios you might want to participate in unfolded below, above, deep in space in all directions, so that you have a kind of huge sets of offerings trying to strategize and know what you should be doing next and what everybody else is doing and what's going on. So this is kind of where we are, and in the kind of retrospect, we're going from unconscious medieval evolution to the Big Bang of architecture, starting with the Renaissance, moving into Baroque, modernism, postmodernism, and deconstructivism as first reactions to the crisis of modernism, and then becoming a transitional episode to what we now call, in retrospect, parametricism. And I come up with the term a few years ago, looking back at over 10 years of DRL research, and I realized how stable and coherent this work was, that it's been cumulative, working on the same principles, on the same agenda and set of values, and that it deserves to be recognized that we are, in fact, although not fully explicit and conscious and put on the table for critique and self-critique, working on a series of very, very stable agendas. Whereas when I grew up and started architecture in the early 80s, I was faced with a kind of keep shifting trajectories and agendas. I was brought up as a kind of hardcore modernist and was quickly confronted with postmodernists. Then deconstructivism came along, then a kind of retro movement of minimalism became prominent. So it seems every 2-3 years a new style was operating, a new movement was starting. And but then since the kind of early mid-90s, I think the last, we had been totally stable and an ever expanding and deepening trajectory, just asking more questions, burdening the project and the repertoire with more difficult programs, and taking up also construction aspect, fabrication aspects, feasibility aspects. So in an overview again, so we have tradition-bound building, the transition to architecture and the Gothic, and then these what I call epochal styles of architecture, each of them redefining what is the beautiful and each of them redefining what is the functional. So each style has also an aspect of understanding and handling functions and aligned with societal eras of development. And that's the way we need to understand styles. There are cycles of innovation which are tied in with overall cycles of societal innovation, because society is not an even cumulative progress. It moves through stages. To this extent, Marx and Luhmann are similar in their theories. And so styles are cycles of innovation, and we have two types of progress. On the one hand, the revolutionary progress is the development and establishment of a new style if there is a real shift in the societal environment. And then within the style, of course, there is cumulative progress. Innovation within an established style is very important, because only if you have that stability of a set of paradigmatic presumptions and ways of working can you actually build your expertise. If you switch to a new style, a new agenda, a new outlook every Monday morning, as Mies would have suggested, you don't get anywhere. You just keep going around in circles. And each, it is not meaningful for each year and or each second year to kind of re-ask and re-criticize fundamentally what architecture is all about. then you will never get to the kind of cumulative buildup of a powerful style which can finally impact back into the built environment, which we haven't reached. So I'm distinguishing epochal styles from transitional styles, and these are competing with each other, and then there's a kind of one competitor pulls out, convinces, draws the convergent troops, as it were, and collaborators in its wake, and then kind of is moving. But within a grand epochal style, you can have a series of subsidiary styles. Like in modernism, you have white modernism first, then brutalism, then metabolism, then high-tech, etc. And I also expect this for parametricism. So parametricism is the epochal style after modernism, and it's not just our style, it's not our work, it's a whole generation, a whole huge kind of discourse globally with many participants and also theoretical organs and writings and various arenas and aspects of research, of course, computational processes, of design techniques is one major field, of course, which really empowers and pushes that capacity, but not only our capacity, it's just the microelectronic revolution has also advanced and pushed the economy, the financial system, the sciences, political administrative system, all subsystems of society are absorbing the kind of computational revolution into their capacities. So we have to do that, and there's no going back, of course. And some of these magazines I have contributed my own writings. This is one of them, which I published 2 or 3 years ago. So what is parametricism? I'm just giving quickly the conceptual definition is that all elements of architecture have become parametrically malleable. And we're moving, in a sense, there's an ontological shift from these primitives, which constitute all architectural compositions for the last 5,000 years, including modernism. It was never anything but the agglomeration of a handful of these Platonic rigid solids, one or two or three cubes, perhaps with the roof, a pyramid on top, or a hemisphere, a dome. That's all it ever was, and modernism is no exception. And from here, we're moving to something radically different. Our primitives, what we constitute our compositions out of, are splines, blobs, nerves, particles, and scripts. Instead of drawing, we're actually scripting and creating these elements which are able to go into relations with each other. They are able to resonate with each other, resonate with context. They're not inert, rigid, insensitive bodies which just sit there. And so instead of drawing inert, dead lines with a ruler onto paper or with ruler and compass, we're setting up these dynamical systems. So our lines are arrays of flexing and accumulating with multiple parameters controlled dynamical systems which go into forms of intricate order which we can kind of search and navigate and tease out. So the totally new ontology, totally new capacity to build up this complex variegated order we're looking for and which post-Fortis network society is looking for. And of course the same is in terms of surfaces. We're no longer surfaces treated as simple inert flat planes, rigid planes, but surfaces are registering what's going on around them. They're informed, they're deformed, and deformation becomes information. They're reactive, pliant, and can accumulate information. And the same goes with in terms of volume formations. And just shows the kind of capacity of this way of working, that you have a genotype which kind of differentiate, and you're creating, on the one hand, radically different situations in the urban field, but they're ordered and you can move from one to the other. You're drawn by vectors of transformation and you're able to affiliate and connect and tie in with context. So there's a capacity to adapt, to be context sensitive, to be resonating and be internally differentiated in a lawful, orderly fashion which allows navigation orientation. So this is the kind of essential elements, the advantages, intensification of relations, everything communicates with everything else. And then we can also boil this down now into an operational definition. How do you work in this matter? What do you avoid? This is also important, the kind of negative heuristics, and what do you push? And we're talking about the heuristics, or the kind of instructions by which you can guide your work and critique your work and push your work forward on the level of form and function. What is very important here, that each style is not only about a formal repertoire, it's about a certain understanding and attitude, how to understand and handle and translate functions, social processes. So in terms of the formal principles, negative, of course, these rigid forms lack malleability, they're out. And it's important not to fall back. It's important to stay true with your hypothesis and thesis and not allow yourself any kind of to be rigorous in your research when we're saying that these new principles are pervasive, universal, to avoid falling back, to avoid repetition, which can no longer represent contemporary society, and also to kind of deny that lack of variety and move on and not fall back. And that's why I said we are no longer doing this anyway, and none of us has done it for 15 years. And so these kind of principles are already taboo here and elsewhere. So it's in a sense a retrospective reflection of what we are denying ourselves. And the crisis of modernism meant that there is no longer these Platonic primitives, there is no longer repetition, this monotony has been rejected also in the real world. What happened instead is this, simply the agglomeration of pure difference, the collaging of one element being placed next to another, and that's happening all over the place. It was aestheticized and celebrated in postmodernism. It happens all over the globe, and I call it the kind of garbage spill model of urban development. And what is the problem here? That's the kind of pluralism of styles, the pluralism of effect, the laissez-faire of anything goes. It's simply the lack of order and produces visual chaos, and it looks the same everywhere, like a garbage spill looks the same everywhere. No matter what is in, it could be radically different in each garbage can. Once you spill it, it all looks the same, and that's the kind of problem, the lack of identity, lack of order, lack of recognizability. So no pure difference. And where do we go from there? So we've rejected the principles which have governed architecture for 5,000 years, including modernism. We're rejecting what has, since the crisis of modernism, happening all over the world, which can be summed up with the garbage spill model of development. That's what it is everywhere, globally. That's why it looks everywhere the same. Even though it is, in objective terms, everywhere different, it looks all the same because it's all this white noise of the garbage spill. Where we're going is this kind of complex intricacy of self-organizing natural models. That's where we're going. This complex variegated order we find in nature, and now we can simulate it and bring it into our design domain. I mean, Ferrotto did it already with going with material computational models, self-organizing form, not inventing form, but finding form or letting form organize and coalesce out of a kind of principle rule-based setup. And we can now do this, of course, in a kind of second nature way with all the animation tools, the simulation tools, which we're drawing out of the science simulation, out of the animation industry, which is all about simulating natural processes, lawful processes, parametric processes, self-organizing processes. And this is what this stuff looks like, and these are already some years old, these images, but they're still kind of relevant. From the different studios we've been teaching at AA, Vienna, Innsbruck. And the kind of models we're using are, we're still going the Ferrotto way, often at the DRL, for instance, with material form-finding processes, but then we always go into the digital domain as well with these. So this is the kind of world we're exploring, the world of parametric formations and some of our work, which is inspired by this. So this is what the stuff looks like. And in terms of the principles, on the positive side, of course, all forms are malleable. So instead of these Platonic bodies, we have kind of malleable and transformable and bodies which I can kind of differentiate and attach. We have another example of such a torus form, and it's asymmetrizing itself, it's differentiating itself and becoming adaptive to conditions. And of course, we can make these malleable forms intelligent. We can inbuilt constraints, functional aspects, inbuilt into the into the setup and then search a kind of constrained universe of possibilities which has already a series of rationalities embedded. And it delivers a complexity of integrating various parameters, and these are structural parameters, which would be impossible to handle intuitively. So that's on the level of individual components and elements. On the level of fields, we, of course, instead of this endless repetition, we're saying differentiation, and we always demand ways of differentiation. Of course, the way you differentiate a field is always multiple. The degrees of freedom you give your elements could always be expanded. So there's here already inbuilt a kind of a project of improvement. Give more degrees of freedom, give more levels of differentiation. And of course, this differentiation is also intelligent. It might have to do with sun exposure of your envelope. And you can obviously utilize some of the engineering intelligence and drive your tectonic differentiation. But in the end, for me, the project is not an engineering project, it's a project of articulation. Not only are these surfaces more adapted and well adapted, but they also allow us to orient, and it becomes legible which direction the building turns even under an overcast day. So there's also a kind of differentiating and articulation agenda, of course, pushed here. That's as a core competency of architecture. You can also apply this to urbanism. We had done that with parametric urbanism for a number of years at DRL, and we're now applying this way of working to all our urbanism projects at the office. So not only is it kind of differentiating, it might be adapting and reading topography aspects, it is also becoming a lawfully differentiated diversity, so you can again navigate vectors of transformation in the field. And most importantly, the aspect of correlation. So that not only are you differentiating your systems and subsystems, but you have multiple subsystems, which could be as different as you like, and I like them the more different, the better. But you can now start to associate across these differences and make one dependent on the other. So for here, for instance, there's this kind of differentiated system of the pleated and folded and undulating surface, which generates the seating and lighting gantries, etc. And then there's a kind of second system, the system of lights, which is now rule-based, correlated onto these surfaces, scripted onto these surfaces. The tower is kind of interacting with the ground plane, creating this kind of ripple and radiating crater effect. So every action has a reaction. That's the kind of correlation across radically different systems, tower versus ground surface, or the various, the tower section kind of migrates from a square section to a T section to an H section, aligned, correlated with program from retail to office to residential, and then correlated the variation of the facade from closed to curtain wall to balcony. So these are the kind of differentiated and correlated subsystems. And the same with this tower, where you have each system kind of differentiated. The skeleton is not the same structurally, even from the bottom to middle to the top. It needs to differentiate. You can again use software to generate data sets which drive the differentiation of the skeleton, so as an intelligent differentiation. It even recognizes kind of asymmetries generated by deformation. And then you can correlate other subsystems, like the openings, closed versus open. And there's a rule of correlation, or the way the floor slabs are setting in, each of these in the ontology radically different, but correlated and associated and recognizing what the other systems are doing, and therefore becoming, in a sense, representations of each other. So one system gives you inferences about what happens to the other systems, like here, where you have the cores pulling into the asymmetry, which generates rips, which are projected from an equidistant position and onto it. So here, wherever it is tight, you have a further distance to the envelope. Where it is getting close, it is closer to the envelope, where it's spaced out further. And the depths of ribs give you information about how far the slab stretched, if you like. So everything gives information about everything else if you tie in these associative logics. And the final aesthetic expression is one of awesome, intricate order, which can only generate through, I believe, such quasi-laws of nature and the association of subsystems. And you get the sense of kind of intense, correlated, integrating differentiated subsystems. And here again, the formal heuristics in terms of the three taboos and the three dogmas. But I think it's also important that this ties in with functional principles. We have a totally different understanding of our tasks and the social life processes we need to accommodate. No fixed stereotypes anymore. The program is not a simple list of accommodation with five items, which are stereotypes. No social homogenization. We're no longer in that era of the single consumption standard, and no segregative zoning. Instead, bringing things into close proximity, so everything is exposed to everything else, melts and intersects and integrates. Everything communicates with everything else. So these are the negatives. That's what we're no longer doing. And on the positive things, we're saying all functions are parametric variable event scenarios. That's the way we understand events. And we now, as I said earlier, indicated, we're now kind of modeling them through crowd modeling, through functional crowds, through agent-based systems of multiple parameters from smaller to medium to larger crowds with various behavioral parameters. So that's the way we understand functions. All program domains are differentiated, and everything communicates with everything as a kind of principle. So it's very important that we have a congeniality between the formal principles of building up these architectures and our attitude towards function and social process. So again, we have the functional heuristics of parametricism, and these heuristics are simply instructions. You can self-criticize and push your project by saying differentiate more, correlate more. These are infinite projects. You can always differentiate more. You can always give your elements more degrees of freedom. You can always correlate them further with further, more distant object. Everything can be drawn in so that you have an... there is never... you're never at the loss of how, along which lines and dimensions to progress your project further, to push it further, to heighten its intelligence, to heighten its elegance, to heighten its intensity. So these heuristics are direct instructions of how to push your projects to the highest heights, if you like. And they're at the same time tools of criticism and self-criticism. So now I want to also show you that this is not only a set of principles and student work, but it's become real, and I'm showing you just the reality of it in Zaha Hadid Architects. These are all realized projects where they start with products and furnitures and smaller installations, and they're moving across product domains, across scales, across all functional domains, and we have the same principles and ways of working, delivering, I believe, high performance results in all these domains. So there is a kind of small segment of reality where this work becomes real, I believe, and is no longer in the stage of a kind of manifesto experiment which needs to a lot of tolerance and excuses for its lack of functionality. Some of these projects are absolutely high performance, global state of the art, I would say, global best practice results based on these principles. And I believe that parametricism delivers global best practice. You cannot fall back behind them and still think that you can contribute to the advance of contemporary civilization. So, of course, this is important for us also that we have the kind of high-performance productive centers in our repertoire. Of course, it's also museums and the capacity of the style to, on the one hand, integrate with existing structures, urban textures, integrate with different urban directions, to pick up a complex L-shaped site, to have these kind of multiple affiliations, the coherence between inside and outside. I'm not sure if another style could deliver such a compelling, convincing, kind of embedded and yet richly diversified event space with these moments of deep vista and penetration where you look from the outside into the inside, where you get a sense of simultaneity, where the architecture unfolds above, below, and layered deep in space, so that you can participate in many events and scenarios and make multiple choices. It then kind of quiets down but keeps pulling you through. It's not like room A, room B, room C, like a snapping from boundary to boundary, but a continuous drift and draw, a continuously changing and migrating space. With every step, something new comes into view. It never stops, it always continues, it always draws you through. There are quiet areas and quiet moments of contemplation, but then they open up again into these kind of moments of complexity. They pull you out, connect you to the exterior, to the courtyard areas. They suspend you, connect to the outside, and through the outside back to the inside. And these kind of moments of deep vista and connection are the ones which we find particularly interesting. And there are certain laws of transformation. You can navigate wherever there's intersection and crossing, there's vertical connection. And the and it really goes through infrastructure projects, through urban projects, park projects. And this one I want to hold on for a second. That's the project we just will finish this summer. It's a big cultural center in Baku, Azerbaijan, which a museum, a library, a conferencing center integrated with a park. The attempt to kind of integrate the outdoor surfaces with the functionality here of spillout spaces for the conference center, with a central entrance and a great kind of connective lobby space. It looks different from different sites. It has certain closed conditions, certain open conditions. The backside is quite interesting. It's a cafe spilling out to this side, so it generates different exterior condition. It looks different from each site, but it's always recognizable, the different components and how they interact. The lobby has a great kind of connecting the space of simultaneity, which then differentiates out into the museum, into the library, cascading up, conferencing rooms, and the musical hall and conference center. And again, the kind of principle of a system differentiated rather than having this collage of multiple aspects. We always trying to bring multiple functionalities under a ruthless and rigorous formalism, in a sense to reduce visual complexity and but increasing, as it were, the offering and social complexity in the space. And of course the attitude of the way the staircases are pulled out, again trying to not add additional elements but kind of modulate and differentiate a system. And of course curvature is always able to cope and comprehend more richness and integrate more aspects, functional aspects, without allowing the scene to kind of disintegrate into visual chaos. And just a few more glimpses. Again, this kind of space of simultaneity and density of visual information to plot out your trajectory so you never waste time. You always have many, many choices what to do next. Also aspects on urbanism. So I'm saying pragmatism is real. It's a drop in the ocean, but we've grown from 4 to 400. But I still think that we need to gear up, and that's my invitation, to push this stuff into the mainstream, because I think it works, it performs. We just need, as a discipline and discourse and as a collective network of researchers and designers pull together and finally make an impact on this planet. Thanks.
Like to take a few questions?
Oh yeah, we would love to. I hope we can have a bit of a Q&A.
Okay.
Oh, we use it's ever expanding. We're using a lot of different tools, but we have a small group of experts working with Maya and Mel scripting, but also we're using Grasshopper, using C++. There's a lot of, we have a whole network of scripters internally, and we created a wiki where people, so we have a little research group, they're doing kind of foundational research, they read particular scientific papers and trying to translate them into algorithms, for instance, a kind of, we created our own catenary models and a kind of dome ribbing algorithms. But we also have embedded in the different projects, we have our various scripters, and we created the Wiki where they post their scripts, they're distributed around. You can also monitor how popular these scripts are and these plugins are. So there's a kind of internal culture that's very important. But the tools keep proliferating. We're starting using processing as well. And we're also investing in the kind of downstream translation. So we build a group with the capacity of digital projects. We, of course, work also with other expert firms like Gary Technologies. And we hire in and collaborate with mathematical outfits like Evolute. They're kind of mathematicians specializing in computational geometry, or into outfits which specialize in electronic shop drawings. So we're having a network of also expert support, and we're trying to build our internal skill set up. We're also working, of course, with Revit. And it's a kind of never-ending attempt to upgrade ourselves, to look out for new tools, and as a kind of internal culture. And I think that's so different from the way it was pre-digital, that where you could rely on the same tools, the same skills, lifelong, and now you have to kind of continuously upgrade your skills. And for us, it's important that we have schools like the DRL, where we're kind of tooling up, and each new generation, in a sense, bringing up fresh skills. And some of those who have been there for a while are not always able to keep up. But it's extremely important, I think, that this is a continuous, conscious effort to be on the ball.
Patrick.
Yeah.
Couple of things. They're very kind of going straight to a very small point, yeah. But they kind of open up something. I understand the virtues of the new style. I wanted to ask you about a few things that seem to be holdbacks that you can't seem to surmount.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just take, in particular, the towers. You showed us a tower where all the floors are a different shape. However, there's something intractably identical about all of them. They're all flat, and they all are arrived to by the same elevator and the same door, repeating floor after floor relentlessly. We still have Fordism. We have an intractable Fordism collaged with parametricism. That's one thing I want you to comment on. It's a collage of parametricism with the old model of absolute repetition. They're absolutely flat, repetitively flat. That property of flatness never, never changes. It's relentless and repetitive, no matter what the shape of the floor is. Shape changes, but flatness doesn't. Okay, the other would be, how do you answer, you talk about the garbage heap. How do you answer the critique that all of the variation, that for all of the variation you introduced, it's the same variation? I mean, it's a variation of relentlessly similar characteristics, just as the garbage heap is relentlessly differentiated. So I want you to comment on both of these things.
Okay, thanks. So first of all, I think, yes, the heuristics is precisely also a tool of criticism, self-criticism, pushing forward. You can say, yes, there are still aspects within your array of differentiated floor plates which have been kept stable, like you say, the flatness. And so that is an invitation for you, for me, for anybody within the paradigm to think of whether, non-flatness or what are the degrees of freedom of slope or ribbing or undulation I would give, and what could that afford? But I think it's so I would see that just an invitation to go further within the same principles. I'm not sure if the tower. I think the towers. I use the tower a lot because it's what is interesting here is a kind of tightness of correlated subsystems. And I do believe that the tower is still a viable model in terms of high-density agglomerations. And of course, we also moved in some of our projects and some of our research from a single tower to clusters of towers. And we're trying to see the way the tower lands and interface with the ground surfaces is different. And you could also question whether the type is altogether relevant. I think it still is relevant, it needs to be interpreted. It's nearly the last bastion of Fordism because it's a very high value product. It is technically demanding, so it is much more easier on a kind of ground oriented project to be highly differentiated, and you're much more free rather than piling up a structure into the sky. That made it a kind of what I call the last bastion of Fordism. But I think in some of the research we did at DRL, I haven't shown them here, we can enrich it. We need to be bigger, they need to be deeper, there's a kind of traveling through a kind of changing scape, vertical scape. So we're saying open up atria and navigation, because now it's really a kind of promenade, a differentiated promenade. I mean, the floor. Well, this is one property which stays stable. Other properties keep changing, and the program. I'm not sure if it's a collage. I mean, I'm quite happy that you on the one hand can demand more differentiation, but on the other hand, we already trying to differentiate a lot. We like to use multi-use towers. We're trying to integrate all components. And then you have the move from office to residential. Maybe you can have a work live in between. But I think the differentiation on the one hand is the formal aspect. On the other hand, I now reach the point where the phase of just formal experimentation and just pushing differentiation for the sake of differentiation needs to be reined in a little bit, and I try to motivate more these differences, find reasons to differentiate. But some of this is also just offering. So if we make a field of blocks, you could say, I don't have the specific motivation yet. I just want to differentiate the offering. Instead of making 100 blocks the same, it's non-specific differentiation I also can offer, because I know that the companies, the users of different sizes, so an offering which is differentiated out might be better. Even I don't know yet, have not a detailed motivation. So there's also this kind of heuristic principle, just offering differences. So that could even apply to floor plates, let's say, even not yet motivated in advance. Once users select and settle in and into a differentiated field, maybe there's a certain coherency of who is settling where, and in the end there's a kind of post-appropriation motivation of a differentiated project. But at the same time, I caution and say I want to try to think through potential motivations as much as possible and avoid kind of arbitrary random differentiation. Although at the same time, I'm saying I need to keep always a certain amount of willful and random in the mix. But I'm not sure. I'm not fazed by what you're saying. I have no problem with flat floors. If I vary a lot of other aspects, the size of the floor, the fenestration, the penetration, I mean, the flat floor, I don't know.
Much about what you just said about the variations of the program, the randomness, the distribution of function, the fact that you can sample from another and many various different ones on all the floors. This has always been there in the skyscraper. There's nothing new in it has persisted since the beginning of the skyscraper and it's still with us. The only difference is you're cloaking it.
And a facade you're cloaking what has stayed the same, and a facade that is styled as parametricism. But the interior, in all of its properties of variability, of programmatic variability, of cutting the floor plates out, different shapes, everything about it has been there from the beginning.
From the beginning?
From the beginning of the skyscraper. The skyscraper is fundamentally not changed in your paradigm.
No. I think there was
nothing
a fundamental
new in your skyscraper.
I think there was a fundamental.
The facade.
The greatest innovation, as I'm concerned, was actually pushed by Portman, in terms of hollowing out and creating a kind of internal trajectory.
That was a big move.
Making the elevator a navigation tool. And I think that was profound. But at the same time, you can see, for instance, in the New York one, where he has the stacking of different lobby conditions, you move and it opens up differently. And I think that's a good starting point. And I think that could be more enriched, and other things could hook onto that, that could be expressed in the facade. I don't know. I mean, I think the traditional, the classical, stereotypical, modernist skyscraper is something rather different. It's just that proliferation of identical plates isolated from each other from top to bottom. Structures are undifferentiated. It's also the irrationality of a modernist structural engineering where you have, they realized one thing, that at a smaller tower you can just use the core as stabilizing. Then you go higher, you have core plus outriggers. You go further higher, you have a kind of tubular. But each time they take the whole tower top to bottom with the same system, which is totally irrational. So you have something like, and we saying, and we thinking, well, but there isn't a, where is the tower? Where is the tower which allows the structure to go through a series of phase changes as it might move? Who?
That's what the New York Athletic Club did.
No, the structure going through a series of phase changes. The structure, and to articulate this, for me it's also important that this is not somehow objectively there, that the columns and the lower floors are slightly thicker than the upper floors. There's a lot of redundancy in these structures, and it's illegible. It's not articulated. It just comes across as a serial extrusion. You can turn it around, upside down, and it looks the same. So I don't know why. I think the I find it a bit disconcerting that you can't see the difference between what we're trying to do and what the modernist tower is.
Logical studies that you did where you're willing to accept the development or the DNA of the morphology of social structures, like why the garbage spill that you talk about, why are you unwilling to accept the urbanistic codes, the infrastructure, the zoning regulations, all of that other stuff, which is the synthetic man-made code that shapes the city? Why are you unwilling to accept? You should like the garbage spill, but you don't. I mean, why? And this is related to Scott's second question.
Well,
the desire to have differentiation with that aesthetic uniformity, it doesn't seem to make sense that you would want the code to do it. The code exists, yet you reject it. I mean, reject it as it exists in the world.
Well, I think, first of all, the garbage spill is the most vital we get. So if you had to choose between the kind of collaged intensity of a kind of Tokyo, which has been celebrated, versus the kind of monotony of the Moscow suburbs, it's clear where our sensibility lies. And we needed to upgrade our sensibilities to start to like this chaos, this kind of lust for chaos and complexity. So I say there's an aspect of vitality in this, but I was trying to see beyond that. At the same time, it kind of becomes disarticulated, becomes disorienting. It's just visual chaos. And I believe that we can offer something more intricate where you can absorb more complexity and make complexity legible. But for me, the point is this. It's not only that the kind of richness and offerings are present, but they need to be kind of become navigable, orientable, legible, tractable for audiences. Otherwise, the audiences get kind of confused, paralyzed, and the kind of elegance of gathering and moving from gathering to gathering, from event to event in a seamless, intuitively navigated fashion, that's my vision of it, doesn't take place. So that's where I think there's a kind of relative dysfunctionality in these developments compared to the kind of development I can envisage. And I think we have won competitions in a number of cities, like in Singapore, in Istanbul, in Bilbao, and they have given expanded our scope, for instance, in Bilbao, from one strip to another, because they were convinced that our solutions and our ways of thinking and ways of working can, on the one hand, be contextually sensitive and adaptive and integrate existing structures by allowing us to affiliate to them rather than kind of cutting and breaking against them. They realize that what we able to create and offer is an identity which looks intriguing, looks unique, looks strange. For instance, Singapore, all buildings are aligning to kind of wave formations in the skyline, which are a direct correlation of the size of plot. So there's a kind of legibility and inference. For me, it's always important that the environment is intelligible and that whatever is in your field of vision gives you information and also inference of what lies beyond your immediate field of vision. That you first of all can decompose and comprehend a scene, and also it tells you more about. So you can kind of, like in a natural environment, indigenous populations can kind of read the terrain and read from off the vegetation where the water would be running and off the topography where the water would be accumulating. So these kind of inferences are very, very important, I think. And these are the kind of inferences you cannot offer, you don't have, in the kind of garbage spill where nothing relates to anything else, where every move is arbitrary and disconnected, and therefore you cannot find your way, you have to kind of go by street number and name and other systems. You can't allow the architectural design to guide you through. And we all know that in small scale, the entrance needs to be kind of somehow articulated, and there are multiple entrances, not only be in the right place, but it needs to be kind of, you need to be able to find the entrance. And when you moved in, you need to find the kind of central hub to move further. So, and I'm riding that large. So for me, therefore, the appearance and legibility of the environment is critical.
You're going to have to buy me a new arm if I can't jump in.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you. Okay, I'm dying to ask if we could possibly tease out the nuances a bit between these two different terms of differentiation and difference, which I think are quite crucially distinct. What is that sound? Do you hear the sound? Anyway, I'll talk. I sympathize with this almost megalomaniacal desire to map out all the systems of the world so that you can kind of leverage out what architecture's place is within it. But within that desire, I think there's a difference between how things are and how architecture should operate within the system that is. And that's my question about, I don't know if you've read Shantaram, the novel, but I would phrase this in the term of Kadarbai, the Bombay mafia leader's words, that you might possibly do the wrong things for the right reasons. In the sense that if we can chart out a kind of super history from prehistory, you showed the compounds in Cameroon. I would give the example of the Dogon people's houses in Mali, where the houses are actually differentiated within parts of the body. You have a penis to the house, you have a breast to the house, and it's actually something that's made into a kind of difference rather than differentiation. You were quick to define difference as was noted, the garbage heap, but I would like to offer the possibility, if you'll indulge me, that difference might actually be this kind of forced, articulated space from which architecture reserves the right to criticality. And that's what I'm nervous about being lost within a system of differentiation, because as you said, one thing does depend on the other, and that seems to null out the possibility for critique. So I guess my question, sorry that was a bit long-winded, my question is, within this system, if everything is interdependent, if everything is somewhat insular, inward-looking, does architecture reserve any of that right, or is it sort of extradited elsewhere to another system within this map of matrix world systems? Or, let's say, if Deleuze hadn't already killed himself, should he do so tonight?
Well, I don't know. I mean, this work, obviously, what we've developed and the whole discourse of parametricism has gotten a big push and input from Deleuze and Guattari, particularly Thousand Plateaus, in terms of concept like the rhizome or smooth versus triadic space, the assemblage versus the organism, and so on. Assume all these to be kind of redeemed and picked up and elaborated in this work and in our conceptual universe. I think that in terms of the global theory of society, what we need to realize is that the autonomous discourses are kind of co-evolving, and they're autonomous in respect to how they adapt to everybody else. But they have to adapt. And that's on And if they don't, they make themselves irrelevant and disappear, and somebody else will step forth and pick up the mantle of architecture. For instance, you have Mavericks, you have the whole of the 19th century historicist architectural profession disappearing, and you have the usurpation of non-architects effect, like Korb, Mies, these were not trained architects, out of the academia. They reinvented and picked up the mantle and made architecture relevant again. So the death of architecture is always near. We have the discourse has the responsibility to keep itself relevant, to adapt, to understand, to make itself congenial and relevant to the rest of society. But in doing so, ideally we are autonomous. It's discourse-led, it's theory-led, and it's not client-led. If clients kind of butt in and trying to force a solution, then this whatever that comes out is not going to be architecture, it's not going to be recognized. The rationality of this is that we have an expert discourse, which is not pushed about like a pinball or like a, but is able to absorb challenges and informations and work through those challenges, informations on the basis of an accumulated wisdom and set of categories and aspects, so that whatever is a challenge is mediated with all the other aspects which are at the same time pouring into the profession. And you can't allow an individual aspects to be pushed and forced through by outsiders. It needs to be the expert discourse working that through. So it is self-referential closure of the expert discourse to have a more high level and sophisticated nuanced response. So it's openness through closure. That's the logic, and that goes for all the function systems of society. So same goes for the systems of the sciences, for the economic system, etc. Now, that's, I think, one point you were kind of pointing to. The other point I noticed that you think there is a, I was rejecting collage and pure difference in terms of the way we build up a kind of rich information and complex urban texture. And I think if in a simpler world, you can start placing, simply you build up differences, a kind of collage, and you create a manifold of 3, 5, 7, beyond 7, we already kind of must chunk and group somehow, because we can't hold mentally more than 7 items. And it becomes a kind of, we're decomposing always already. And if you add 12 and 13 and 15 and 25 and 55 and 57 different items, a manifold, a pure manifold of pure difference, that's just becomes that white noise. It's simply, is no order whatsoever anymore. So the point is here that the differences need to be tractable, they need to be perceptually palpable, and they need to be comprehensible, because the built environment is not a machine which operates objectively through machines, but it is a built environment which operates through sentient, perceptual, cognitive beings. We need to navigate that environment, find each other, and what isn't perceptually palpable and comprehensible isn't there. It simply doesn't exist, except in the kind of crudeness of physical force. Yes, you can distance and separate, but you can't intensify communication by channeling the cattle through objective logic. That's why I said the degree to which is society, the built environment, functions as a system of signification and through nuanced demarcations which are not physical, the higher level of society it is, and more sophisticated it is, and that's what we need to cope with. And I'm saying what isn't visible, what isn't part of the appearance and becomes legible, isn't there, isn't in the domain of architecture. So if you tell me that you've kind of richly differentiated it, there's a lot of information embedded in your model, and I don't see it, I don't perceive it, I don't sense it, I can't find it, then it isn't there, full stop, on the most relevant level. So that's why I'm coming in and saying the pure difference is no, it stops after 13, after 17, and then you need to kind of build up order. And also the first question, the next question is, do you have a manifold of 17? Should they just be scattered at random, or you want to kind of chunk them, group them, order them, sequence them, gradient them, and so on. And I'm always interested to push the complexity, the richness, on the one hand, and then absorb it into kind of legibility and order attractability. So I'm also interested in subsystems which are ontologically radically different. And maybe have two, three, four. You're no longer in the stage of a single system, one kind of surface modulating and folding and so on and doing everything. No, I'm interested that they're radically different subsystems. They are surfaces, they're kind of swarms of particles, they're kind of singularities which radiate and ripple out. They're line systems, and they're kind of volume systems, and they're kind of negative hollowing out and Boolean out systems, whatever they are. But the point here is, the more I do that, I always have to kind of have that aesthetic judgment and legibility issue of whether this is kind of in the domain of architecture or is just a kind of illusion and collapses into white noise. And white noise is dysfunctional because white noise will not elegantly bring communicators, participants in where they want to be efficiently and have things at their fingertips and move from communication to communication, because that's what we need to do every day. We need to do 50 things, perhaps, and be in touch with another 50 things and make the right choices. So that's why I'm insisting so much on pushing the phenomenology of space, and also on the next level I realize it's a semiology, because the phenomenology is one aspect which relates back to our capacity as perceptual beings. I'm looking at gestalt psychology, how do you decompose a scene, and how do you kind of construct units of interaction in your visual field. That's one aspect, but I also realize that you need to tie it in with a systematic correlation and system of signification, because if you perceptually, and these are tied in with each other, if you listen to Chinese, all you get is white noise. You can barely distinguish the words, the repetitions, and so on. So without the kind of semantic layer being tied in with that, you actually perceive less. So that's where I'm coming from, and that's the kind of, let's say, the project where I think everything has to do with the productivity of communication. I'm instrumentalizing everything. There's no fetishism. And I feel that in your question, I have the sense that there's a kind of fetishism of pure difference there, but I might be wrong.
Hi. I came to your lecture fascinated by parametricism and maybe aspiring to adopt many of its principles. And certainly the images you've shown us are very sexy. But at the same time, there's something incredibly oppressive, stifling, authoritarian about your whole project. These curves that essentially cannot ever be changed. They're a sculpture that is the artifact of a process. And what agency do the inhabitants of your structures have to influence the structures based on their daily life? You speak of them as if they were cattle, simply drifting through sentient beings.
No, I'm contrasting this to the cattle, yeah.
sentient beings, but nevertheless sort of just drifting along these mathematical formulae you've already invented for them. So I personally think that's disturbing, and I don't aspire to be sort of this all-controlling being. I hope that people have some agency. So what do you have to say to that?
Well, no. I get this kind of criticism a lot. First of all, but I think it's fundamentally based on a misunderstanding. Just the refusal, let's say, if these are very abstract principles, right? I'm just asking you, look at the elements you compose with and see if you can give them more variables, degrees of freedom. I don't tell you which degrees of freedom, which geometric entities you should start with. I'm only asking you, have you given them some degrees of freedom? Do they have the ability to adapt, to respond, to vary? You know, that's very open, and it's just and I'm saying, if you refuse that, I wonder, you just stay with what we've got. We need to also worry about in the avant-garde, where's the project which has an original challenge, something to work through, invitation to invent, to be creative. And I think that's the way I see this. The second is the differentiation. You have an element. You create a kind of field. Which additional ways of differentiation could you invent, create? What rules of differentiation do you come up with? Rapid, slow, what kind of degrees of variation would the field contain? How is this differentiation ordered and structured in the field? This is very, very open again, and it's just an invitation. You've done it, you've done a number of iterations, and then an invitation to do more. Is there yet another kind of radiating, rippling differentiation which could be absorbed by the system? And then we come into the concept of correlation. You know, these are just open invitations to develop a set of principles and to fall back behind to say, no, I don't want to do that. I want to keep my options open. I don't like to be kind of told how to work. Then I think that's very abstract and empty, because I wonder what you would pose. We had it before, maybe the position as well, I want to have something which is not connected, which remains disconnected, which remains unique and separate. And I can say, yes, you can do that. And that's, if you work like this, a collage fashion, what's the challenge, what's the interest? It collapses after accumulating a number of different items. It is also that easy, because if you work like this, you just set difference against difference, each design move is equally easy. You just throw another piece at the composition, and then you throw another one. It's not challenging, there's no skill, there's no intelligence. You're not building up something, whereas what I'm talking about, it's really something you have to work hard on, whether the system can incorporate and resonate with yet another object, maybe an object at a distance. Can that still be registered and be sensitive to? You don't have to do it, but it's an invitation to push further. And that's where I'm coming from. It's very, very open. It's very, very open-ended. It's challenging all of our creativity. It tells us, instead of intuitively fiddling with vertices and doing something local, arbitrary, you can start like this. We all do that. We sketch. And say, what I've done here, which principle or rule can I bring this under to allow that to apply to all similar conditions and tie these together. So that's the kind of thing, always rule-based, always scripting. These are heuristic principles, invitations. And if you keep saying, no, I don't want to do this, I want to fiddle intuitively wherever I am, you can do that. That's what we've always been doing. So I think it's up to you to see the progress, the capacity, empowerment in what I'm proposing and what lots of people are doing. And one more point on the level of curve. The curvature is another thing. I've been talking about the kind of non-corner architecture. Of course you can build up an architecture with corners. And if you try to build up a complexity, for instance, you start with boxes. Box next to box, that's fine. Box intersecting with box is interesting. One box intersecting another. Bring in a third, bring in a fourth. You quite quickly lose sense. They're all just orthogonal lines, there's corners. You don't know whether you're in one box versus another. You don't know how big the box is. If you build with curves, if they intersect, you see where the concave your inside, convex your outside. The size is read off the radius or size of the curve. The continuity of curvature to tie in things together rather than a line which keeps breaking. It just falls apart, it breaks apart. You can't hold complexity, you cannot build up complexity. So I can demonstrate to you here, you design something where you use only straight lines and kinks and corners, and I'm designing something where I'm working with curves. And mind you that a straight line is just one infinite radius curve, and a corner that you will not be able to compete, and that there is a kind of superiority in working with curves on clearly statable criteria, meaning the amount of complexity you can build up and remain legible. That's a simple kind of test we can make. I'm not inherently against, I think, for simple, small spaces, for little environments which have no much going on, I'm perfectly happy to use flats and straights and boxes, and also to use a contrast between boxes and curvature. That's where we started, using the orthogonal and the diagonal as a contrast. But as you build up and want more, you will see that the kind of the curvature-based, the curvilinearity-based system has an advantage over the orthogonal or straight line system. And yet, of course, we're also going beyond that. It's not all about continuous curvature. There's also swarm formations where particles and fragments, if they are just left standing, they don't tie together, it falls apart. But look what we've been doing. If you take all these fragments and bring them under a force of a transformational gradient or a kind of a force field, you work with attractors and these self-organizing systems, you can sense how units of interactions and relevant connections can be articulated and aggregated. It's simply this. It's just the question of what is brings you further. And if you can demonstrate in your repertoire that you are more nuanced, more resonating, can integrate more contextual affiliation, you can articulate more differences without the thing falling apart into a kind of white noise, then I'm quite happy to do that. I mean, for me, it's well, it's not to be distinguished. What I'm saying is, the inhabitants will have to be able to read and navigate and gather and find themselves and decompose this complexity you're building up. So they have to be able to. It's all about the elegance and convenience and intensity of a life process.
So listen, yeah. Patrick, we have had a wonderful evening. There's been a great intensity here. But I have to tell you, our guest, who's come far, will not have dinner at all if we don't eat now. So I really want to thank him. And you should all, I hope you would welcome the students to continue a discussion with you in some form. Through communicating with you continuously, because your energy, your intensity, your dedication to these ideas is really remarkable, and I haven't seen anything like that in so long. It really is exciting. Thank you so much for your lecture tonight.
Thanks for your attention.